Okay, now that you understand how to set up one of these autoregression problems, let's do something fun. In particular, let's consider a problem that's a data set that is pretty different than what we've done for the rest of the tutorial. And we're going to be trying to model sequences of zeros and ones. So to start with, let's start with just really simple deterministic sequence of zeros and ones, where it's just strictly alternating. It goes 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, okay? I'm going to code it up in a particular way just to make the math a little bit easier, where these digits, I'm going to map ones onto positive 1. I'm going to map 0 into negative 1 just to make the math a little bit easier. And so what you'll see is that to get from each number to the next number, all you have to do is multiply it by negative 1. Okay? Now, what happens if this deterministic sequence of zeros and ones is not following that pattern? Let's consider another pattern that's slightly more complicated, where it's 110, 110, 110. Okay? It's still entirely deterministic. It should be completely predictable. However, one state in time is no longer sufficient to determine the next one. To see how this works, we'll see that let's say that you are at plus 1, right? If you're a plus 1, the next one could be another plus 1. Or if you're here, you start at plus 1, the next one is a negative 1, right? And so what you quickly have seen is that in order to predict what's going to happen in the next time step, you can't just do it based on the current time step. You need a history of 2. You need a slightly longer history in order to predict what's happening next. But you should still be able to predict it perfectly because there's a very clear pattern to the sequence of zeros and ones. And so what we can do is generalize the autoregressive model that we had developed in the previous part of the tutorial by looking at what are called higher order autoregressive models. Higher order just means higher order, a longer history dependence. So the next time point is dependent on the previous time point, like before, but also potentially on the time point before that, and the time before that, and the time before that, as far as you want to go, okay? And so the order of this autoregressive model, this higher order autoregressive model, is simply defined as how much history do I need? How many steps in the past am I really going in order to predict what's going to happen in the future? So in this diagram that I've shown here, if I needed the previous 3 time points to predict the next one, this would be a third order autoregressive model. That's just the terminology of what it's called. And so you can see here that even though we can then very perfectly build a model for deterministic sequences of random numbers, if the random number sequences are pseudo-random, you can still build a higher order autoregressive model to try to predict the next one. Now, here's where it's really fun. Humans are notoriously terrible at generating random sequences. And this is why we have computers and various other types of processes to try to generate pseudorandom numbers, because we are so terrible at doing it ourselves. When I was making this tutorial, it occurred to me that children are agents of chaos. And so I was wondering whether or not a child can generate sequences of digits that are at least pseudorandom, right? So I recruited the closest child I had, which is here, my son, who is 9 years old. I sat him down at my computer and I told him the rules. I told him how to do this. He was supposed to put in digits of zeros and ones as randomly as he's able. And here's what he typed in, okay? So this is in your Jupyter notebook right now, the sequence of zeros and ones that my son typed in. And your goal is going to be using a higher order autoregressive model to try to predict the sequence of the random digits. See if you can predict what he was going to type next. And this is actually a really interesting way of not only modeling pseudorandom digits, but also exploring the effect of the order R on the model and its performance on unseen test data. What you'll see is that as you slightly increase R, as you look farther behind yourself in history, the model should predict a little bit better because there's a little more pattern to it. But as R gets too large, you start overfitting the training data and it no longer does as well on the test data. So that's what you're supposed to see when you do this exercise. In the words of my son, when I showed him this model, "I can't believe I'm so predictable." If you want to take this challenge yourself or get your kids involved, have them type out some random digits and build a model to predict it.